This assembly will come to order. Please remain standing for the invocation to be delivered by College Chaplain Jeffrey McCarn.
We gather here under the great tent that Samuel Kirkland pitched 223 years ago with his American Indian friend Chief Skinandoah, with educational hopes for his Oneida and Iroquois brothers. We come here today, of course, from 1,000 different belief systems and worldviews, but maybe we all have this singular magnetic attraction to what is just and what is good and what is wise. And if that is true, let us bow down and invite justice and goodness and wisdom to shower down upon us this morning and on this burgeoning presidency for our college. So, Athena, help us. We know we have a tendency to bend the truth to make ourselves look good. Forgive us when we do that. As individuals and as a campus community, we have a tendency to follow the money and the social power at the expense of being true to ourselves. Forgive us. Give us strength and courage to be true to ourselves and to you in your justice and goodness and wisdom. Bless our brother David. Lead him and thereby us onto this sacred ground given to us so that our longhouse of learning might flourish. Teach us how to ignite the light of community and to lovingly blow the breath of encouragement onto the fragile flame so that our fire might burn brightly, warming those who feel themselves on the colder, unincluded edges of our house. Teach us how to create a light in our midst which might illuminate the faces of those who stand in the shadows of our house so that we will all believe, so that we will all know that this house belongs to all of us. Bind our new president and thereby us to our most closely held values, to know ourselves as individuals and as a campus community, and to tell the truth about ourselves, to love our world, to offer our highest thoughts, our deepest expressions, our earnest efforts to heal the earth and the fullness thereof. Look with favor upon our new president. Whisper to him words of encouragement in moments of despair. Wash him in the waters of courage and in times of uncertainty. Dial up his powers of listening, especially to the one who will not be able to reward him for being heard. And finally, in the words of the prophetic philosopher from the great state of Minnesota, may God bless and keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. And may you stay in this land of perpetual 18 to 22-year-olds forever young. Amen.
Please be seated. It is now my honor to introduce the president of the Hamilton College Board of Trustees, Stephen Sadoff.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us on this historic occasion. I want to begin by welcoming the members of the Platform Party, the Hamilton College Brass and Percussion Ensembles, the College Choir, community leaders, members of the Hamilton community, and the dozens of delegates from colleges, universities, and scholarly organizations from across the country who are with us this morning. We are grateful for your participation in this inauguration ceremony for David Wippman as the 20th president of Hamilton College. You honor us with your presence. We began the search that led to David's selection nearly 2 years ago with a long list of objectives that we wanted our new president to fulfill. Specifically, we were seeking someone who would lead the Hamilton community in creating a bold vision for the future, who would build on the strength of Hamilton's exceptional liberal arts environment, who would support and encourage faculty during a time of renewal and transition, who would deepen the campus culture and commitment to diversity and inclusion, who would ensure a vibrant and safe campus life, who would create a sustainable financial model, and who would increase Hamilton's visibility and engagement beyond the campus. In other words, we wanted it all. I'm delighted to report that we found a person with the experience, intellect, leadership, and vision to move us forward on all those fronts. David has a deep understanding and affinity for the liberal arts, a strong appreciation of the academic world, its scholarly values, and its professional culture. He's a strategic thinker who possesses the skills to execute a vision in a practical and inspiring way. Add to that a record of building and maintaining external relations and advancing an organization's profile and reputation. And finally, he has a demonstrated respect for academic freedom and diverse opinions on key social and political questions of the day. Most importantly, he has the ability and desire to lead Hamilton in a discussion about the future of the liberal arts and undergraduate education in an evolving national context and in an increasingly globalized society. He takes leadership of an institution that is among the most well-managed, financially sound, and highly regarded colleges in the country. We gather here at a time that is as historic as it is challenging. We are delighted to have attracted to Hamilton a person with the intellectual and personal qualities to lead us at this auspicious time. Someone with a deep passion for liberal education in a residential setting. I look forward to working with David in the years to come. It's now my pleasure to introduce the college choir under the direction of G. Roberts Kolb. I now call on representatives of Hamilton's many constituencies, beginning with Student Assembly President Kareem Nugent, to offer greetings to our new president. Following Kareem, we will hear from Ann Owen, representing the faculty, Xiaofeng Lin, who will speak on behalf of the staff, Carrie Burns Evans, who is here representing the local community, Gordon Kay, who will deliver remarks on behalf of the alumni, and Bob Delaney, who will bring greetings on behalf of the Board of Trustees. Kareem, will you please come to the podium?
Good morning, students, faculty, staff, community members, parents, alumni, trustees, and other distinguished guests. Welcome to this inaugural event, and I'm honored to be speaking on behalf of the student body. So as I was thinking about my speech, I wondered what could I tell you about David Wippman? And I sort of reflected back on our biweekly meetings. I could tell you about how often he goes to Utah every winter to ski with some old college buddies. I could tell you about that one time he gave expert advice to my vice president, who wishes to study abroad in India. He told her, make sure you don't forget your Pepto-Bismol. I could tell you about the time he attended a student assembly meeting last semester. And in our first encounter, I told him, I'm the real president of Hamilton College. that's so not true. But on a more serious note, if there's anyone that I trust to serve as the president of Hamilton College, it's David Wippman. I can honestly say that he not only cares about the students, but he makes a valiant effort to get to know the students. During our meetings, he's always trying to figure out a way to get to know the students. Despite comments being pretty intimidating, especially around noon, David Wippman is always there eating lunch and always interacting with the students. If he's not cycling with students, President Wippman is backing our blue, and you can check out his Instagram, it's true. He's always attending several sporting events on the weekends and showing his school spirit. I'd like to think that David Wippman knows what it's like to be a Hamilton student just as much as I do. Hamilton students truly want administration that will not only listen to their concerns, but take them into consideration and offer possible solutions. Students want a president who will take into account multiple perspectives and one who's not afraid to go against the norm. Personally, I know that President Wippman, AKA D. Whips, or the famous D. Whitman, as a student called him during her radio show after expressing how much she admired him, is truly in a position to bring change on this campus, and I know he won't disappoint, or I expect him not to. It's been a pleasure getting to know you, President Wippman, and I look forward to working closely with you.
It is my honor to represent the faculty in welcoming David Wippman as the 20th president of Hamilton College. We do this at a time of great opportunity for liberal arts colleges generally, but especially for Hamilton as it welcomes new leadership. We live in a time that is characterized by rapid change and uncertainty. Among other things, our students will face the challenges presented by the consequences of climate change, an increasingly complex geopolitical landscape, growing inequality, and significant demographic change in the U.S. and many other developed nations. But at Hamilton, we face these realities with the knowledge that those who are best prepared to embrace unexpected challenges and to creatively solve multifaceted problems are those who are broadly educated and stand on the firm foundation of a strong liberal arts education. We look forward to working with President Wippman to prepare our students to live meaningful lives in today's world. For those of you who know the Hamilton faculty, you may appreciate that often we passionately debate from multiple perspectives and experiences. We rarely speak with one voice, but today we do. David, we welcome you into our intellectual community, and we invite you to work together with us to provide the very best liberal arts education.
President Wippman, on behalf of the staff, I would like to welcome you to Hamilton. I know you are beginning to find your way around, as I have seen you cycling through Clinton and the surrounding towns. I would like to let you know that as you begin to explore more, we, the staff who live in these surrounding communities, are here to help you understand the terrain and give you a heads up if there's a steep hill looming ahead. As you embark on this journey as president, if you come upon a hill you're not expecting, please know that you can rely on us, the staff, your teammates, to work with you and support you to ensure that you overcome that obstacle. Thank you, welcome, and best wishes for a long and productive tenure at Hamilton.
I'd like to offer a big welcome to our newest friend, David Wippman. Greetings as well to all visiting dignitaries, Hamilton College faculty, staff, parents, and students, and all the townies out there like me. David, please allow me to cover some history of this special place to show how rich it is in the pursuit of education. Clinton was founded in 1787, or just 6 years before Samuel Kirkland started the Hamilton Oneida Academy, that you know became Hamilton College in 1812. Interestingly, Reverend Kirkland's efforts were matched and emulated many times over as Clinton, New York became known as the Village of Schools. Altogether, some 50 private schools and academies have operated in Clinton, including the Houghton Seminary, where Clara Barton was educated, and fun fact, two Hamilton graduates make their home today. A few other notables who are educated in Clinton are Elihu Root, Grover Cleveland, and Leland Stanford. History lesson over. As I thought about this day and the message I wanted to share with you, I kept coming back to the realization that our communities are truly woven together. I want to share the townie perspective of that thought. We have professors and Hamilton employees as neighbors and friends. Our kids pet sit for some. We send our children to Hamilton sports and leadership camps. Our kids become littles to Hamilton bigs. We attend sporting events and sacerdote lectures. We support the Town Gown Fund, and we send our children to Hamilton. Another fun fact, my great-grandfather had a general store where the Subway shop is today. His hard work allowed him to send my grandfather and two brothers to Hamilton. And since then, 14 other family members have passed through this campus, my dad and two brothers included. And maybe number 18 is sitting out there for the possible class of 2025, huh, Sid? We also have many great assets to share in our wonderful community. We have our own art center, town library, summertime concerts, farmers market, the ABC program, garden club, Kiwanis Club, arena, historical society, town pool, town park, terrific restaurants, and a shop for just about everything. We have so much to offer that I'll leave you with this community guidebook for your reference, David. I follow you on Instagram, like many others, and I'm excited to see that you're making your way around the Hamilton community, although I'm not quite sure I understand the tinfoil caps. As you settle in with your Hamilton family, we invite you to join the greater community as an active participant for many years to come. So, David, on behalf of the Clinton and Town of Kirkland community, I welcome you.
Thank you, Carrie. My name is Gordon Kay. I'm president of the Hamilton College Alumni Association. I would just say before I start my prepared remarks that I recently heard a speaker call Clinton the Versailles of Utica. Something to think about. Anyway, it's an honor to greet and welcome you on behalf of Hamilton's alumni, both those returning to the Hill and those all around the world. I was recently reading a letter from the Hamilton Historical Archives, written by a very early 19th century alumnus of the college, and he was bragging about the accomplishments of his class. At the height of his rhetoric, he summoned the greatest praise he could think of for his classmates. Quote, "None of us went to jail, and none of us served in Congress." The more things change, the more they stay the same. So here it is, two centuries later, and I have that same urge to praise our alumni today. President Wippman, you will find the alumni of Hamilton College to be loyal beyond all reason, accomplished beyond belief, articulate beyond all sense, stunningly intelligent and disciplined, creative and warm and loyal, funny and generous and loyal, insightful and challenging and loyal, fascinating and supportive and loyal. And did I mention loyal? We are diverse in opinions, attitudes, ages, lifestyles, increasingly so in geography, race, gender, and ethnicity, and in every other possible way. But we share a few things. We share the understanding that there is something unique and enduring about the College Hill education and experience and how it shapes us. We share the sense that this beautiful and dignified campus is forever home. We share the awareness that Hamilton has always marched to the beat of its own drummer, not always in the right direction, but most often toward a more perfect institution. We share the commitment to undergraduate education and in particular clear communication, lifelong learning, and genuine collaboration. And we share the pride that we are increasingly looked upon nationally as an example, and I would argue the example, of what a liberal arts college can and should be. And so on behalf of decades and centuries of alumni, I thank you for rising to the challenge of guiding this institution to new heights. Please look upon us as a repository of the history and traditions of this magic place. I welcome you to our unique community, look forward to your contributions, and pledge our support and loyalty. Thank you.
Good morning. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I would like to extend our warm welcome to President Wippman. 18 months ago, the board began a search for the finest possible candidate to become Hamilton's 20th president. From a deep pool of candidates, David Wippman stood out as the one person who had all of the qualities we were seeking in a new president. David is an exceptional academic leader with proven administrative skills, a strategic thinker who can lead the Hamilton community in creating a bold vision for the future, an educator who is passionately committed to students and the liberal arts residential model, a scholar who can support and encourage Hamilton's outstanding faculty, an expert on international law and human rights who has demonstrated a deep-seated commitment to diversity and inclusiveness, and an approachable and engaging leader who can cultivate and nurture the loyalty of Hamilton alumni. President Wippman, you are taking on a challenging assignment, making an extraordinary institution even better. From all accounts, you're off to a terrific start. We, the members of the board, pledge our support to you as the new president of our beloved college. We look forward to working with you and the rest of the Hamilton community to make Hamilton even better at providing its students with an exceptional liberal arts education. Please accept our heartfelt wishes for a successful and brilliant tenure. Thank you.
Thank you for those wonderful expressions of welcome and support for our new president. It's a real pleasure for me to introduce our next speaker, David Wippman's good friend, Vice President Walter Mondale. Mr. Mondale's Minnesota roots run deep. He received his bachelor's degree from the University of Minnesota in 1951 and his law degree from the university's law school in 1956, having served on the law review and is a law clerk in the Minnesota Supreme Court. He represented his native state as Attorney General and U.S. Senator before being elected to serve with distinction as Jimmy Carter's Vice President in 1976. Since leaving office, Mr. Mondale has been practicing law, teaching, studying, traveling, and serving as a director of both for-profit and nonprofit organizations, including election in 1993 as a director of the Council of Foreign Relations. From 1993 to 1997, he served as the United States Ambassador to Japan. And in 2008, he was on the search committee that selected David Wippman as the Dean of the University of Minnesota Law School. We are honored that the 42nd Vice President of the United States is with us this morning to share his reflections about the 20th President of Hamilton College. Please join me in welcoming Vice President Walter Mondale.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, Steve, for those very kind words. I'm really glad to be here with you at Hamilton to honor my dear old friend, David Wippman. There are many Minnesotans here who came all the way across, halfway across the country to be here. We didn't have to be. We wanted to be here to tell you how great, how gifted, and how kind and wonderful David Wippman is and will be here at Hamilton. Maybe I could ask Dean, we have several educators, lawyers, and the others, could the Minnesotans that are here to honor Wippman please stand and sit down as fast as you can. I met Dean Wippman when I was a member of the search committee looking for a new dean for our great law school. And some of the other members of that committee are here today. I think they'll agree with what I say. We looked at a broad span of gifted candidates, but none of them matched Dean Wippman. And the committee thought it over and unanimously recommended him to become our dean. He was dean for 8 years, and goes down as one of the great deans in Minnesota history. He's a brilliant man. He's got values. He's honest. He's kind. He's a scholar, a teacher, a good American, and it's the kind of influence that we came to expect from him. And I think he, from what I hear about Hamilton, that will fit just fine here. I've had a chance to meet some of your graduates over the years. I served with Saul Linowitz. How many of you remember Saul Linowitz? Saul was one of the great diplomats of our time. We were dear friends. We wouldn't have had a Middle East agreement without him, and or the Panama Canal Treaty, certainly without him. Always decent and kind, and always knowing and knowledgeable about what he was doing. He's received many, many awards about his spectacular leadership. There are others, and I'm going to mention one, maybe two. Drew Days is in the crowd today. Drew Days is one of the truly spectacular civil rights lawyers of our generation. And most of the civil rights legislation that was passed during that era would have passed in weakened form if it hadn't been for Drew Days. He's now on the Hamilton Board of Directors. Wonderful man. And if I may, I dwell on him just a little bit because I think it's a sign of what Hamilton College produces that can change the country and change the world. Yesterday I talked to Tom Vilsack, Secretary of Agriculture, a graduate of this college, wanted me to tell you how much he loved Hamilton, and former governor of Iowa. These are the kinds of leaders that you've been producing in for our country, and which your graduates coming up will go in many, many different areas. But I hope some of them will help us straighten out this mess in America. I've been fortunate to be in public life for ages. My first campaign was for Harry Truman and for the mayor of Minneapolis, Hubert Humphrey. And I've been through it all. I've seen it all. I've been in the state capitol. I've been in Washington. I've been around. And I don't like what I'm seeing now. We had a sort of haphazard politics in the past, but it's been basically principled politics. And the people that rose were those that told the truth and who inspired people to believe they had a better vision of where America should go. It always wasn't right, it certainly wasn't always the way I wanted it to be, but basically, living up close, I trusted it. And I think the American people had a chance to be heard. Now I'm worried. We're going to have a debate Sunday night. I don't want to get into politics today. But I think we need to make certain that when this is all done, that we restore with clarity and energy the great values that Hamilton Colleges and your leaders, college and your leaders have brought to our public life over the years. Thank you, David, for your key role in getting that done. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I call on Mr. Sadoff to present Dr. Wippman with the symbols of his office.
David Wippman, the trustees of Hamilton College have authorized me to deliver into your custody the charter of the college, the original document that goes back to 1812, the possession of which is one of the symbols of your authority as president, and to invest you with the presidential chain of office. Mr. Schwartz, will you present a candidate for an honorary degree?
Mr. Chairman, I have the special privilege and pleasure and honor of presenting for the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws, David Wippman.
It has been said that American colleges and universities are the envy of the world, and residential liberal arts colleges represent what you call the gold standard of this country's higher education system. For more than two centuries, guided by inspired and determined leaders of wisdom, vision, and experience, Hamilton College has served as a shining example of American higher education, delivering an unparalleled academic program that prepares its students for lives of meaning, purpose, and active citizenship. Indeed, Hamilton is as strong an institution as it was at any point in its previous 204 years. Even the college's namesake and first trustee is more popular and venerated now than during his lifetime. Yet Hamilton College aspires to be even better. In you, we welcome a president dedicated to accelerating the momentum that propels your college forward. Liberally educated and legally trained, you have constantly sought new challenges throughout your already impressive career. A native of the Twin Cities, you moved on from high school after just 3 years. That means you didn't graduate from high school. To take courses nearby at the University of Minnesota before enrolling at Princeton University, from which you received your bachelor's degree summa cum laude with election to Phi Beta Kappa. Intending to become an English professor, you entered the English literature program at Yale University on a fellowship, but switched fields, subsequently graduating from Yale Law School, where you are editor-in-chief of the prestigious Yale Law Journal. But you're an educator at heart. After clerking for the chief judge for the U.S. Court of Appeals, Second Circuit, and practicing law for nearly a decade in Washington, D.C., you returned to academia, holding teaching and administrative positions at Cornell Law School and Cornell University. Withstanding as an exceptional legal scholar and a well-earned reputation in international law, you became the Dean and William S. Patti Professor of Law at the University of Minnesota Law School. Now, finally, you have arrived at the place you were always meant to be, a residential liberal arts college where you can lead, inspire, teach, and participate actively in what you call the lateral learning that takes place outside the classroom. With enthusiasm, great anticipation, and immense pride, we heartily welcome you as the 20th president of Hamilton College. David. David Wippman, acting on the authority of the Board of Trustees, I am very pleased to confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Laws of Hamilton College, admitting you to all of its rights and privileges, in token whereof we present you with this diploma and invest you with this hood. We will now hear from the Hamilton College Brass and Percussion Ensembles, after which President Wippman will deliver his inaugural address.
Good morning, and welcome everyone. I am touched and honored by the extraordinarily warm welcome that has been extended to me by all members of the Hamilton community and by the comments of those who have preceded me on today's program. I owe too many debts to too many people to thank them all today, but I know you will forgive me if I mention a few. Kareem, I know you're the real president of Hamilton College, but thank you for letting me use the office. I want to also thank Steve Sadoff for his extraordinary service as chair of the Hamilton College Board of Trustees. I wish my parents could have been here to hear Steve's introduction. My father would have loved it. My mother would have believed it. Let me also thank the family and friends who have found their way to Clinton today. I confess that a few of them expressed some uncertainty as to the precise location of the college, but I'm happy to have provided an occasion today to resolve that question. I owe a special debt of gratitude to my 19 predecessors in the president's office, and in particular to President Joan Hines Stewart, who has been a fabulous resource for me from the moment I was named to this position. Special thanks to Vice President Walter Mondale. As you know, he is one of the greatest generation, a Korean War veteran, Minnesota's youngest attorney general, U.S. Senator, Vice President of the United States, Ambassador to Japan, diplomat, author, and statesman. He is best known, of course, for his service on the 2008 Minnesota Law School Dean Search Committee. It's a great honor to be named president of Hamilton College. As I reflected about what I should say today, I thought I might find inspiration in our political leaders. So I watched the acceptance speeches at the Democratic and Republican national conventions, and I thought, how hard can this be? All I need to do is make extravagant and completely unrealistic promises. But then I remembered I had already done that during the presidential search process. So let me instead say a few words about Hamilton's past, its present, and what we might achieve together in the years ahead. All of us understand that our alma mater cannot stand frozen in time at the moment of our graduation. Yet when we return to the campus years later, it's natural to feel some disappointment to find that the college has in fact changed. Alexander Wolcott, a 1909 graduate and prominent literary critic, described his own return to the Radiant Hillside in 1932 in a way which, if a little tangential to my theme, may nonetheless strike a chord. My visit, he said, observed all the approved formalities, including a football game, some hours of choir practice with one of the finest choruses in the country, and a few calls at one faculty house where they go in rather more violently for string quartets than I find altogether restful. Wolcott added that my visit to the Hill was marred by only one serious mishap. After the first quarter, in which the scores stood Rochester 7, Hamilton 0, the silence in our grandstand was broken by a solitary burst of applause. It came from your correspondent, who, as it turned out, had watched the game that far under a slight misapprehension as to which team was which. I mention this because many of you will be going to the football game later this afternoon. Just to be clear, our players are the ones in blue. The present generation of undergraduates, Wolcott went on, have a rather more luxurious life than we knew. A reminder that we tend to judge the past by our own memories of the present. We tend to judge the present by our own memories of the past. I want to talk a little bit about some of the differences, with particular reference to student activism at Hamilton and around the country. In its early years, as described in Professor Morris Isserman's Magisterial History of the College, On the Hill, Hamilton was very much a product of his times. It was all male and all white. Students were drawn almost exclusively from upstate New York. There was no admissions office, prospective students appeared on a given day to be examined by the faculty. Those who passed started class immediately. Those students may at times have felt a little isolated, but in fairness, the stagecoach to Utica ran on both Tuesdays and Fridays. For over 100 years, the college followed a classical curriculum, lots of Livy and Cicero, and a little arithmetic and geography. Tuition was $30 a year for upperclassmen, $21 a year for freshmen and sophomores. Students got up at 5:30 in the morning and attended chapel at 6. Meals consisted, on a rotating basis, of boiled meat, roasted meat, and hashed meat. Weather permitting, students could bathe in Oriskany Creek. Otherwise, they had to haul their own water up from the campus well. Of course, students had the offsetting benefit of daily lectures in the chapel from the president. This is a tradition long since discontinued. But whether that is to the greater relief of the students or the president is unclear. From the outset, the college had strong views about moral education. Azel Backus, the college's first president, stressed the importance of inculcating religious and moral principles, and he condemned light reading and gaseous information. We're still not fond of gaseous information. But beyond that, President Backus would find little he would recognize in today's Hamilton. Tuition is just a bit higher. Chapel attendance is not what it was. And Livy and Cicero, though still taught in the classics department, no longer dominate the curriculum. We do still care about values, but our approach is a little bit more nuanced than it was in Azel Backus's day. Of course, it is not now and never has been the role of the college to urge any particular set of political views. Quite the contrary. But as a colleague and friend observed at commencement ceremonies in Minnesota last spring, politically neutral does not mean value-free. Our values are implicit in our mission, and our mission is to prepare students for lives of meaning, purpose, and active citizenship. We want our students to learn to think independently, to embrace difference, to write and speak persuasively, to engage issues ethically and creatively, so they can make a positive difference in the world. Stated in the abstract, this mission attracts broad support. But what does it mean to prepare our students to think ethically, to embrace difference, or to be active citizens? The devil is in the details, and if you don't mind my mixing my metaphors, when push comes to shove, there is a lot of pushing back. Let me give you two examples. Last spring, Hamilton adopted a new diversity requirement. The new policy mandates that all Hamilton undergraduates take at least one course as part of their major, dealing with issues of structural and institutional hierarchies. Why adopt such a requirement? Whatever their backgrounds, our students now live, work, study, and socialize in a diverse, multicultural, global community. They will learn more and fare better now and after they graduate if they understand the ways in which social relations can be structured by perceptions of groups and group identities. Encouraging students to embrace difference is something the college believes essential to a contemporary liberal arts education. A second example. In recent years, students at Hamilton and around the country have protested various forms of injustice on issues ranging from police misconduct to sexual assault. In some cases, these protests have included demands that colleges and universities do more to create an environment on campuses that is safe and welcoming for all students. Supporters have praised students for tackling larger social issues, including institutional racism and other forms of bias. Critics have decried perceived threats to free expression and the open exchange of ideas. In a much publicized letter to incoming freshmen, the University of Chicago announced this fall that it does not support trigger warnings or intellectual safe spaces. Some, like the Heritage Foundation, declared that the letter made them want to stand up and cheer. Others suggested the letter was a publicity stunt, a way of coddling donors rather than students. So what's going on? It's certainly possible to find things to caricature in some of the demands made on various campuses. But there's something much more fundamental than occasional student excess at play in recent debates about campus activism. Our students are living and studying in a much different world than most of us encountered when we were in college. They no longer haul wood and water. The food is a lot more varied than boiled, roasted, and hashed meat. And the curriculum and campus environment are incomparably richer and more diverse. That's all to the good, but it means our students must navigate differences in ways that few people in our society are accustomed to doing. As two college presidents, Barry Glasner and Morton Shapiro, put it in a recent op-ed, students today arrive from communities and K-12 systems that are largely segregated by race and income. But while on campus, a daughter of a hedge fund parent may room with a daughter of a migrant worker. A straight Republican may share a room with a gay Bernie Sanders supporter. Everyone is here, and everyone lives together, if not in perfect harmony. Even as our students navigate their new lives on campus, the outside world confronts them with a string of tragedies, both national and international. Police shootings and shootings of police, terrorism at home and abroad, metastasizing wars and streams of refugees. As they try to make sense of all this, our national political discourse continues to deteriorate. I can't remember a presidential campaign this course, even though I know, and our namesake could attest, that it has at times been just as bad. In the midst of all this, is it any surprise that our students protest some of the injustices they see? And surely we want them to care and we want them to speak out. So why has there been so much criticism when they do? Much of the criticism stems from a perception that contemporary students are intolerant of views that don't align with their own, that they try to silence other students, denounce faculty and administrators, and disinvite or shout down outside speakers who don't toe a politically correct line. And no doubt that has sometimes been true. Indeed, concerns over intolerance for dissenting viewpoints led the Hamilton faculty to adopt the following statement. Free inquiry and free expression are indispensable to the attainment of those goals to which Hamilton College is dedicated. All members of the college community should be free to examine and discuss all questions of interest to them, to express opinions, and to question, but not suppress, the opinions of others. It's a good statement. It's also 5 decades old. It was adopted in 1967, another period of political turmoil and frequent campus protests. And its commitment to free expression remains as important as ever. I don't mean to suggest that nothing has changed. The Knight Foundation recently surveyed college students and adults in the United States about free expression on campus. It found that students are actually more likely than adults to say that colleges should expose them to all types of speech and viewpoints. But students, especially women and students of color, are also more likely than adults to support restrictions on speech if it is intentionally offensive to racial or ethnic groups. Indeed, some two-thirds of the students surveyed supported such restrictions. Evidently, many students are willing, to some degree, to restrict speech in order to foster a positive and respectful learning environment. Students recognize that this approach has a cost. A majority acknowledge that the climate on college campuses may prevent people from saying what they think, for fear that others will find it offensive. Even if we disagree with that approach, as I do, we should acknowledge that students are responding to real problems of intolerance and bias on campus and off. We should understand that if we want them to be engaged citizens, their engagement may take them where we are unwilling to go. Most important, we should work together and work hard to create a campus environment in which all students feel welcome and all students thrive. Doing so, in my judgment, means reaffirming our commitment to the full and free exchange of ideas. That is a core value of this college and of liberal arts education. Adhering to this commitment is more likely to lead to the achievement of a just society, on campus and off, than compromising it in the hope of minimizing conflict. At convocation this year, I emphasized to incoming students the importance of engaging with viewpoints with which they may strongly disagree. I noted that doing so will not always be easy, and it will not always be comfortable. But easy and comfortable are not part of our educational mission. Intellectual, social, and moral development are, and they occur when we confront new ideas and consider other perspectives, even if we find those ideas and perspectives uncomfortable. At the same time, our students' desire for a learning environment that supports all of their classmates is entirely laudable. We must do more to foster such an environment, so that when our students engage with ideas that are difficult or offensive, they can do so in a productive and respectful way. For over two centuries, Hamilton has continuously reinvented itself to meet the needs of a changing student body in a changing world. But one thing hasn't changed. The college still provides a life-changing, transformative education. Oscar Wilde once observed that education is an admirable thing, but nothing that is worth knowing can be taught. But then Oscar Wilde never went to Hamilton. In fact, much that is worth knowing can be taught. Our faculty teach it every day. Perhaps it is better still to say that much that is worth knowing can be learned, because teaching is not simply the passive transmission of knowledge from the front of the room to the back. It's about enabling students to discover and pursue a passion, about enabling them to change the world. The opportunity to partner with all of you in preparing our students to change the world is precisely what makes my new position so exciting. I look forward to getting to know each of you better and better, to learning from you, and to working with you to make this wonderful college, this splendid and special place, ever more splendid and special. Thank you.
No, please remain standing for the singing of Charisma, the words to which are printed in your program. Please remain standing for the benediction to be delivered by College Chaplain Anat Guez.
Shehecheyanu is an ancient blessing from the Jewish tradition. This is a joyous blessing that is recited at a new beginning and special occasion like ours today. This blessing speaks to our thankfulness for our life, for our journey, and for a new beginning ahead of us. It is by praising God that we bestow blessing on those we wish to congratulate. Please join me in a blessing, in blessing our 20th president, Mr. David Wippman, with the blessing of Shehecheyanu. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Shehecheyanu Vekiimanu Vigianu Lazman Hazeh. Blessed are you, God, God of the universe, for giving us life, sustaining us, and allowing us to reach this joyous time. Amen. Welcome to President Wippman.
Please remain in your places until the procession has left the auditorium. Everyone is invited to the picnic taking place on the tent on the Dunham Green. This assembly is adjourned.